The following message by Pastor Dennis Clark and Dr. Jennifer Clark is brought to you by Full Stature Ministries and its supporters. For more information about Full Stature Ministries, please visit forgive123.com. That's forgive123.com.
Ever see something like sediment in a liquid, and then it begins to settle, and slowly but surely the liquid gets clearer as the sediment settles? That's exactly what it felt like in the spirit. So if you've been all shaken up, hopefully stuff is settling to the bottom, and then we're going to put our finger on that stuff in the bottom and you get rid of that, and then you get really purified. So it's going to be a work of settling into his presence and then exposing the sediment and getting it out. We're going to be like a water filter this morning, only we're going to have living water filtering out and purifying the stagnant water. If anybody has any stagnant water, it's going to manifest today. Thank you, Lord, for this day and for this opportunity and for the continued blessings of your goodness. And as last week we were talking about soaking in the goodness of God, I couldn't help but wonder, God, what is my reciprocal response to soaking in your goodness? And he basically said, take worship to a new level in your personal life. If you're soaking in his goodness and you're absorbing it like a sponge, then what should be the reciprocal action? In other words, how do I honor you more? And he says, let the worship go into a deeper level. So I wanted to share some things on a call to worship. And of course, you know us, we can't just tell you what it is. We have to tell you how to do it. And that's the exciting part for me. But I believe that God's going to give us a picture of what worship's going to look like. There's going to be a new breed of worshipers that are going to emerge out of the church. And what's interesting is, since I don't sing or play an instrument, when I was a young Christian, my first bookmark for my Bible was Dennis, worshiper. And I'm going, okay, but I don't sing, I don't dance, and I don't play an instrument. But he basically, the challenge from the beginning of my Christian walk was that a worshiper is a lifestyle. And how to implement a worship heart in everything that you do, in not just in a worship setting like in church. And so I want to give some instruction this morning. Father, we just pray that there is a call to worship, that you're calling us to a deeper level of worship than mere form. For we understand the context of worship, but that's not what you want. You want the content of worship to be the reality in spirit and truth. And so, Father, we just thank you that you who began a good work is going to continue that good work. And let it begin today. Okay, first of all, everybody worships. Did you realize that? Even unsaved people worship. Just a question of what and who. What or who, right? But you are made a worshiper. You will worship something. It's not a matter of, oh, I think I want to. No, you will worship something or someone. But that is the one thing that separates us from the animals. We have a spirit, and that spirit is yearning to worship. And it'll worship the right way or the wrong way, but it will worship. It's not a choice. It's something that you will automatically, spontaneously do out of your innermost being. So why not do it properly? Why not do it according to the way we were created in God to worship? So I think even before we begin, the purpose of our worship, of course, is to honor and glorify and bring pleasure to the heart of God. So it's not just whether or not something is good or bad, but it's in reality, how is it relate in relationship to God? In other words, is he first place? I can remember ministering to Jennifer when we first got married. Her dad basically worshipped education. Education in and of itself is not a bad thing, but you know, you can carry anything and make an idol out of a good thing. But that was, it was to the point of idolatry. It was that important. And I'm saying, fine, have it important, but where does it relate in position to God. If God is not first, that has become an idol, and it will deter you from a heart devotion. So some of the legitimate things in our life can actually be a scattered charm. And that's what it says in Jeremiah 3. Let me read this to you. Jeremiah chapter 3. It says, "But you have played the harlot with many lovers." And yet there's a call to worship. He says, "Yet return to me, says the Lord." Isn't that something? You hear the compassion in that? It says, you played the harlot with many lovers. You've scattered your charms. You love a lot of things, in other words. You may love me. He's speaking to Israel. He's speaking to his people. You may love me, but you basically have too many lovers. And I'm asking you to return to me. In other words, put me first place. And in chapter 3, beginning in verse 13, it says, "Only acknowledge your iniquity that you have transgressed against the Lord your God. And you have scattered your charms, you've scattered your ways, and to alien deities under every green tree. And you have not obeyed my voice, says the Lord." Return. There's the lover's call. There's the lover's call to worship as you were created to worship. He says, "Return, O backsliding children, for I am married to you." That's a lover's plea. That's part of what we talked about last week as far as the wooing of his bride. He's drawing with cords of love, and these are loving words, even if they got correction in them. I don't mind being corrected if I know that the correction's coming from someone that loves me that much. That they say, "You break my heart because you've drifted, but yet at the same time I'm calling you, please return to me." I mean, how could you not respond to that? How could you not want to? This is not a have to, this is a want to. "And you've not obeyed my voice." He says, "Return, O backsliding children, for I am married to you. I will take you from one city and two from a family, and I will bring you to Zion. I will bring you to a place of mature unity and the centrality of worshiping. I will give you shepherds according to my heart, and I will feed you with knowledge and understanding." You know, our worship must show adoration and loyalty to God for his grace. But it also says that God gives grace. He resists the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. Humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord. He will lift you up. Worship God is a very humble and reverent thing. We've seen that in any arena, if something is to go astray, it'll be in the area of not being able to get lost in God and putting him first. You can worship, you can be part of a worship team primarily with the attitude to be seen and heard, out of a need to be needed. That's an improper attitude. There's people that basically can dance before the Lord, but they're dancing to perform. And that's a heart condition. In other words, it's not about performing for people to be seen and heard. It's about honoring and reverencing God. So the motive of the heart is significant in worship. So I just saw that God seeks true worshipers, and he identifies those who worship with him in spirit and in truth. Now, most of you are, in your minds are thinking in the context of formal worship in a church service. I'm thinking of worship as a total lifestyle. And so there's two factors. The first one is, if you're going to worship God in spirit, it means it has to be done from the heart. Real worship has to come from here. It's just like singers. They teach singers to sing from the diaphragm, not from up here, right? I don't know anything about singing, but that's what I heard. All right, but you can do everything from the neck up, and it sounds kind of tinny. And quite frankly, by discernment, this will make everybody paranoid, and I don't want you paranoid. I want you to just discern the spirit. You have the equipment. But there's times when I've heard people share, even in an open mic setting or whatever, and they're trying to share something God said, and it sounds tinny because they're doing it strictly from their intellect. Now, no one's going to come up to the microphone. I hold the microphone and go, "What if I sound tinny?" You know what I mean by that? You could say, "Jesus saved me yesterday." And everybody, like, there's no anointing on it, but there's nothing wrong with the words. And then there's someone who comes up and shares, and they might even be able to get the words up, but you feel the presence of God. It ushers in. It's almost like the old story, you've probably heard this a million times, about one man who prided himself, and that was probably the problem, prided himself in his ability to articulate, and he did the Lord's Prayer. I mean, he did the Psalm 23. Psalm 23, the Lord is my shepherd. And he articulated, and everybody went, oh, that was wonderful. But then they said a little man who basically had a speech impediment, but primarily loved the Lord with all his heart, he started speaking Psalm 23, and the people began to weep. That's the difference. Worship, true worship, has to be spirit and truth, correct? The spirit part has to be out of the heart. It's out of the abundance of the heart the mouth speaks. So it's the source. So true worship must be a matter of the heart. And secondly, and here's the part that I don't know, we wiggle on this one. Not only does true worship have to be from the heart, but true worshiping God in truth means that it is done according to the way God specifies in the Bible. Now, some people balk at that, but if he is the one to be worshipped, he has the right to declare exactly how that worship should be performed. It's really that simple. And yet, since he's the object of that worship, he alone determines how to worship him. Jeremiah 10:23 says, O Lord, I know that the way of man is not in himself. It is not in man who walks to direct his own steps. We're not really granted the option of directing our own ways in religion. God is the one we look for guidance and direction in our lives. And so I'm just seeing that Jeremiah 3, that there's a call to worship, but there's a call to warning, isn't there? You know, you played the harlot. Please return to me, says the Lord, for I'm married to you. There's a loving God. If he's calling us to worship, he's also calling us to correction so that we get to true north, that true heart devotion with him according to the ways he says we should do it. And so I don't have a problem with the fact that that's what he's doing. So let's look at worship just a little bit. Psalm 95 is actually my Bible even has Psalm 95 as a call to worship. As the little heading. I know those headings change from translation to translation, but these mine says it's a call to worship, but what I saw in Psalm 95, particularly in 95, was the posture. It says, verses 6 to 11, if we start there. Oh, come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker. There's a key right there, bow down. That means that there's significance in bowing down. When I first got saved, nobody taught me, is there a particular posture to pray and to worship God? But I had no problem sliding out of bed and kneeling by the side of the bed. It was just a form of honor. You don't have to kneel. You can sit, stand. My spiritual dad used to go to prayer meetings, and he would lay on the floor, and his feet were up on the wall. I never saw that one before. But it didn't much matter. It's where is the heart while you're doing it, all right? He'd lay on his back, feet up on the wall. One time we had a prayer meeting that the power of God came so strong that there was people plastered against the wall like this, and people on the floor, plastered on the floor. And the guy on the wall told me that he couldn't tell if he was on the floor plastered to the floor and those people were plastered to the wall or vice versa. He didn't know because he was plastered in the presence of God. The weight of God came and he was just there. Totally, totally lost in God. So position, I don't think is that important, but the heart is, and the position of the heart is where we bow down, truly. So let us bow down, let us kneel before our Maker. I think to worship from the heart is a posture, and I think it's an attitude that we need to understand. The second thing we need to understand in Psalm 95 says that he is the God and we are the people. That might seem like a minor statement, but in reality, that's the heart of worship. He is the God, we are the people. When you really, really recognize that in your Christian walk, that God is God and you are the people, you're worshiping him. It's the lesser worshiping the greater. And then you begin to enter into and understand covenant properly. But when you think that he's there to serve you, you've got a problem. You're there to serve him. The highest duty of man is to worship. Worship and the word, priority one. When God literally laid out a heavenly design for me to plant a church, priority one was the center pillar, and it was worship in the Word. And in that order, worship in the Word. Because I've seen people who worship the Word, but have very little reality of God. No, you worship Him from the heart, has to be from the heart, in spirit and in truth. Some people would worship the Word. I know unsaved theologians. Jennifer has got her doctorate in theology, and she questioned the salvation of some of the people that wrote it. So you can love the Word and be a lover of the Word and not know God. All right? You can make an idol out of anything. But worship in the Word is, it has to be from the heart. It has to be from the spirit. It's got to be spirit and truth. And for me, truth is not just a written word, but truth is the reality that He's a living Word. So worship Him in spirit and truth. It needs to be a lifestyle, and that lifestyle responds to God. So it says, He is our God, we are the people. For He is our God, we are the people of His pasture and the sheep of His hand. That probably, like I said, as though it seems simple, that's probably a priority in your prayer time to see if it's really Him that you're serving. And what the warning that I see in verse 8 is that even though He's drawing us with cords of love in Jeremiah, in Psalm 95, that's called a call to worship, in each scenario there is built in the loving call of God, there is built in warning. I find that interesting. And listen to what it says. Do not harden your heart as they did in the rebellion. As in the day of the trial in the wilderness, when your fathers tested me, they tried me, even though they saw my work. They saw how I loved them and demonstrated it in a tangible way, and yet I was grieved with that generation. It is a people who always, I don't like that when God says always. That's a little scary, isn't it? They are a people who always go astray in their heart. And they do not know my ways. If you go astray in the heart, you're not going to know God's ways. Remember, the people saw His works, but Moses knew His ways. And because he was a meek man and a worshiper. And because if you draw near to Him, you will learn His ways. And it's more important at this day and age that we learn His ways than we learn about Him. We need to understand the ways He operates in our lives so that He can direct our path. And that worship then can be, as we stated, a lifestyle. But it's a people that go astray in their heart, and they do not know my ways. So I swore my wrath, they will not enter my rest. That really puts a pressure on me to encourage people to deepen that relationship with their God and prioritize accordingly to the Word of God, because our whole ministry was based on the family mission that the message we were bringing of how to practice the presence 24/7 was so that mature sons and daughters would become Sabbath sons and Sabbath daughters. Sons and daughters that know how to enter into His rest and live there. Because in the end times, Daniel says, the enemy's going to try to wear out the saints of the Most High God. But they who intimately know their God shall be strong and do exploits. Sons and daughters are going to have to be Sabbath sons and Sabbath daughters. And I'm not just talking about taking Sunday off. I'm talking about living in that rest, operating out of that rest. It's like being enthroned with God on a motorized wheelchair, all right? You basically can move about, but the effort is not you. You've entered into that seated position. You've entered in that place of ruling and reigning, but in that ruling and reigning, there is movement, and you're there. You're not striving. It's the opposite of striving. So if we were to look at this, Psalm 95, and see that there's both a call to worship, a very intimate call to worship, but there's also a warning. I guess this warning is saying, this is not a time to say no. Do you agree? This is not a time to say no to God. It says, harden not your heart. Don't say no to His will or to His obedience. Today, if you hear his voice, harden not your heart as they did in the trial. Because when you say no, you're saying either no to his voice or no to his works. In other words, the things that you've done for me, God, so what? And you want me to do something, I have a better idea. There has to be seen that we fail the test when we've seen his works and we still say no. Sometimes I think it would be good for you to just journal some of the things that God's done for you. Because it's very easy, if the children of Israel could forget how he parted the Red Sea and delivered them out of the hands of the Egyptians, and if they could do it in such a short period of time, we're all capable of forgetting and focusing in on what we want and what we need and what's lacking as opposed to what he has already done for us. So I believe that Israel saw God's works, but Moses knew his ways, and God wants to reveal those ways to us. When we say no to God, we refuse to make him number one. Lack of passion toward God. I would even use another word, indifference. Indifference. Because when people scattered their charms and they have many lovers, they don't necessarily reject God with any kind of totality. They just reject, he's just one among many loves. And therein lies the danger. People make idols out of their leisure time, entertainment, family, money, relationships, agendas. If some relationship is more important to you than God, it's idolatry, and I don't care if it's your husband or your wife or your kids. You'd be surprised over the years how many people I've had to minister to release their children. And they were just equating it as love. Yes, you love them, but when you love them more than God, that's not love. You're controlling them. They're God's servants, not yours. Tell that to a mother and see if they don't throw things at me. They are God's servants, not yours. They belong to him, not to you. Remember, he's the God, we the people. You can never lose sight of that fact. They are God's servants, not yours. They belong to him and not to you. God is able to tell them whether they're right or wrong, and God is able to make them do as they should. And all the controlling people rise up and say, no way. If I don't tell them what to do and if I don't control them, it won't get done. And God says, wrong. Wrong. He knows how to humble a proud man or a woman. He knows. And some parents, you thought it was a coincidence that when you finally let go of that unruly child, that son or daughter that was going astray, when you finally released them, you didn't even know that you did it right. You released them not because you abandoned them, not because you're an irresponsible parent, but you released them into the loving, capable hands of God. And guess what happened? They turned around and started going toward God. Control is like witchcraft. It works the opposite. You might think you're sincerely loving them, but when you cling to them, you interfere. If you got your hands around their throats, God's basically saying, if you want to deal with it, you deal with it. You'd be better off letting me deal with it. But if you want to play God, I gave you a free will. How's it working for you anyway, being God? Is everybody obeying you? Probably not. If they don't obey God, why would they all obey you? Did you ever think of that? Mom, Dad, did you ever think of that? If they don't all obey God, why would they all obey you? That son or daughter leaves the house, they can say yes, 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 and then they can leave the house and go do what they want to do. But making idols of leisure time, entertainment, family, I think these things are all things that we've not really pursued God, but if there's a call to worship and there's a call to lordship, then I think we're going to have to reevaluate some good things. I don't think I have to work a long time with a mature body of Christ. I don't have to work a long time teaching them what sin is, as much as I need to show them the things that are not sin in and of themselves that you can make an idol out of. That's where you've scattered the charms. Entertainment, sin in and of itself, of course not. Family, sin in and of itself, of course not. Money, sin in and of itself, of course not. Relationships, of course not. Agendas, any agenda, very ripe territory for the enemy. You give place to him. But failing to seek him first place in daily prayer, not making his word our standard of conduct, not staying accountable to him for how we live by forsaking known sin, making decisions without inquiring about what God wants, living as if our time is our own rather than God's. Oh my goodness, when God dealt with me on that, I was structured, a little OCD perhaps, but I had my day timer was structured in 15-minute, they were pre-printed pages that I had printed for myself in 15-minute segments for the whole day. And guess what I found out in those 15-minute segments? The rest of the world didn't know my rules and they didn't cooperate. They would call me during my prayer time. They would knock on my office door when I was studying. How come no one else knew? And God basically, I wrestled with that. And God basically said, it's not Eastern time, it's not Central time, it's not Rocky Mountain or Pacific time, it's my time. And there was a radical surrender of my time to God, that from this time on, there is no set time. To this day, as far as I'm concerned, we work 7 days a week because I don't have a structure of a timetable. Everybody likes time to spend with family and recreation stuff, although, except then there's Jennifer and I, which we don't really care if we have recreation. Our fellowship even, I don't have any desire for fellowship unless somebody's passionately involved in the things of God. We went to we live in Bailiwick and we went to a homeowners association meeting once. And I'm a people person. I make friends with the waitresses in a restaurant and the grocery store attendants. That's my mission field out there. And yet we went to that thing and I said, we don't have nothing to talk about with these people. It was shallow. It was like worldly topics. I'm just going, felt like saying, y'all need saved, you know. But we just said, you know what, we have to navigate into the place to where we are, I believe at our age, optimizing our gift mix. In other words, this is a time of consolidation. It's a time of integration. It's a time when your gift mix, you should be accomplishing more with less effort, and having learned some of the lessons of the past, how to expedite what God is telling you to do with the least amount of effort, and entering into that supernatural rest of God and walk according to his plans and his purposes and not get sidetracked so easily. So, all right, there's a warning. For 40 years, I was grieved with that generation. This is a people that always go astray in their heart, and they do not know my ways, and I swore in my wrath they will not enter my rest. Okay? So, here's what I want to give you. I want to give you the context of change. This is going to push your buttons now. Write this down. If you don't want to listen, just go la, 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 like that. La, 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 I don't want to hear this part. There are five heart attitudes, but it is not going to guarantee change, but it is clearly the biblical guideline that if you worship God, this is the context in which it takes. Are you with me on that? Didn't we say that up front? You have to worship him in the spirit. It's got to be from the heart. So this is a heart attitude, but it also has to be according to the structure that God ordained as to what worship is, right? Doesn't he have that right to say, here's how I want you to worship? Here's the context. The context in and of itself doesn't change you, but the context is the place where the heart attitude flourishes because God laid this structure out. Heart attitude number one, it says that a leader's heart attitude about attendance is reflected not only by their presence, by the attitude by which they arrange their schedule around services, duty, practices, and so forth, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together. Now, I was born again as a charismatic, and all my charismatic friends were in rebellion against legalism, right? Many still are. And yet, Jennifer and I are of a different breed, and I believe that we're supposed to reproduce according to our kind, and I'm not going to apologize for reproducing according to my kind, in the sense that not my shortcomings, but the good stuff. And the good stuff was is that I arranged my schedule to be around services. Jennifer worked as a school psychologist, commuted 70 miles one way. She left for work in the dark and she came home in the dark, but when men like Randy Lechner and some other prophetic people came into town, she went to those meetings and got by with 2 hours of sleep going to school the next day. I don't see that kind of passion anymore. I don't see that kind of passion because that's not a have to, that was a want to. What in the heart of a believer causes that kind of want to? I think it has to do with priority, and it has to do with God hunger. And I think it has to do with God saying, I'm calling you back to that place. Do you want to come? And I'm believing that attendance is going to come back to where people want to, not have to. And like I said, I was in the charismatic movement, and we all revolted against mandatory attendance. But I'm not talking about legalism, and I'm not talking about context. I'm talking about the attitude of the heart in the midst of the context. Does that make sense? In the midst of that context is whether the motive of the heart is right. But attendance is one of the primary heart attitudes. Forsaking not ourselves as some do tells me that even in the early church, people drifted. The second element is a mature worshiper. Not only has the attendance as a heart attitude, but a mature worshiper has the attitude of cheerful service rather than grudging duty. 38 years in ministry, what I've done is, you know, people always being afraid they're being replaced, but in reality, I don't replace people, I replace function. And I have never worn anybody out in 38 years of ministry. I've never worn anybody out. That's a bad sign that the church does have a tendency to do that. They find somebody that's excited for God, and then they burn them out. And I think that someday they're going to stand before the Lord. They may be doing that unknowingly, but nonetheless, service needs to be an attitude of the heart of a want-to. And when it's a want-to, anything beyond a want-to, you get into religion. Oh, there's such a thing as duty. I'm giving you the duty, but the duty still has to be done from the heart. If the duty is done from the flesh, what good is it anyway? Service is basically I want to, a cheerful giver, because that will produce a corporate body with the right heart, with one vein, with one vision, with one voice, one Father, one baptism, one. It'll promote the oneness that Jesus longs for. Oh, I pray that they would be one, even as you and I are one, Father. But you can't have grudging duty mixed with, you can't have grudging duty combined with people who have the proper heart attitude. It's like oil and water. It's not going to mix well. The service attitude of the heart, the disposition of a worshiper, in the context of service, needs to be, I delight to do thy will. When that's the heart attitude, you're saying something. My food is to do the will of him who sent me and finish the work. And I actually feel like at times I almost have to apologize. Jennifer and I don't do vacations. Vacations are not sinful. I encourage you to take your vacation, but I've never wanted one or needed one. I love what I do, and I've never been burned out. I don't need a vacation because I'm burned out. I don't need to go on a sabbatical because I'm burned out. I want a living sabbatical to where I enter into the rest of God and accomplish more with less effort. I want to have that motorized wheelchair and rule and reign from the seated position, seated together with him in the heavenly places as kings and priests. My food is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish the work. That's a motivation or a heart attitude of worshiper. Attendance, we both did that, Jennifer. Service, we both do that. We still do that. I show up every Sunday. I don't know about anybody else. I'm here every week, several times. However, if you do it out of religion, if you're in church more than twice a week and you're doing it out of drudging duty, there's something wrong with you. You need an appointment. You need counseling. How about that? Go home and tell that to some other pastor. We know this pastor, he just said, if I'm in church more than a couple times a week, I might need counseling. You might need counseling. You might be doing it for the wrong reason. You might be a people pleaser. You might be doing it because you've got a need to be needed. But if you're doing it with the right heart attitude, because I want to, you're worshiping God and you're exalting Him, you're honoring Him, and everything you do, you're honoring Him. That's a worshiper. I want to. I like that in part of your song. I don't have to do anything except love God. I love that. That's really all it is. If I heard that right, it was something like that, but it caught my attention. The third element, if you're watching by Ustream, you're going to love this element. The heart attitude of a mature worshiper is a tither without exception. That's the minimum. A mature worshiper says, where your treasure is, that's where your heart is also. And trust me, when I was a young Christian, I heard all the silly arguments against it. They're actually amusing. Okay, then you want to argue against it? It's all His. Deal with it. 100%. And by the way, don't say you don't tithe. Everybody tithes. Just a question of to which God? Who gets the top 10% anyway? You tithe. Every one of you tithes, and more so. But who's the God? Who's first place? Where's the attitude of the heart? Out of the abundance of the heart, you worship. Tithing basically shows you it is the Lord your God that you are remembering. And when you give, He gives you power to get wealth, that He might establish His covenant. The whole purpose of blessing you is to establish His covenant. And will a man rob God? He said, you've robbed me in tithes and offerings. But where your treasure is, that is your heart. How many see that as worship? Do you know in the spirit, when we receive an offering, the anointing goes down? I'd say the day's going to come when the maturity level is going to be that you can pay your tithes with the same climate, the same spiritual atmosphere as when you're singing a song. Worship is not singing a song. It may include that. But worship is the heart attitude and devotion to God. You know that to this day, by discernment alone, I could have my eyes closed and Vicky breaks into a dance. I can feel the atmosphere shift for the better every time. That's not a performer. Performer, it will not do anything to the atmosphere except create, do you see me? And I don't know what we're going to do. We're going to need a real outpouring of God because I'm really disappointed in the level of discernment amongst people who have been in the church for a long time. There were people who were clearly not anointed that were very gifted, and many people didn't know the difference. That grieved me, that they couldn't tell. The person wasn't really anointed. They wanted to be seen and heard, but because they had great giftings, you thought they were anointed. There's even little things you do in worship, right? We've got worship people here. There's the little things you do in worship doesn't mean the anointing went up or down. It was a transition. I've seen wonderful transitions, and I've seen beautiful things done in the spirit that were according to a good structure to make it easier for people to enter into, but not necessarily were they always anointed. It's the heart attitude. You cannot skip that with talent. Talent will not override that. Where your treasure is, that's where your heart will be also. The fourth element, remember now, these things are not guaranteeing that you're a worshiper. They are merely the context wherein you are developed and can prove your heart attitude. The fourth element is the family mission or vision. A mature worshiper is demonstrated by knowing what is the vision of the corporate, the family, because God places the solitary in families. What is the vision, and am I coming on purpose to support it? That can be financially, prayers, but the intent of the heart of a real worshiper is I want to see the family mission successful. Many people come with an agenda, I have a particular ministry, and I want to see my ministry promoted. I'm talking about, no, I want to see, as one man said, guess what? Do you feel important? Everybody's more important than you. Is that scriptural? Everybody's more important than you. And I see ownership over gifts and talents when in reality, everybody's more important than you. Let it go. It isn't about you. Ouch. But cultivating a proper heart attitude is that it's the family. It's the purposes of God is bigger than Dennis, Jennifer, and anybody else in this building. The purpose of God is bigger. Do I want to be part of the purpose of God? We have people that would like to be with Dennis and Jennifer, but not necessarily do they have a passion for the family mission. That's uncomfortable for us. And they don't understand. I don't reject you. It's just the more we pursue the purposes of God, the fewer people that are walking with you. And that's okay. I'm not stopping. If you want to run to keep up with this, go for it. We'll have great fellowship. So the family mission, or the vision of the house, they used to call it. But Proverbs 29:18, God gave it to me. I didn't pick it. God gave me a heavenly vision 40 years ago. And it's Proverbs 29:18, where there is no prophetic vision, the people cast off restraint and do what they want to do and what they see is best. Where there is no redemptive revelation, the people go astray. And the worshiper and the warning is that they always go astray in their heart. Harden not your heart. These would be the areas where you would harden your heart, the context of worship and the context of being a mature worshiper. The fifth element is a mature worshiper has come to know that there's a spiritual overseer by the Spirit, that it's not his title or his personality, but I want that in desiring an open and approachable relationship with the overseer, God has placed them in fellowship to honor God by serving them over in the Lord. If a mature person is, and let me make this real simple. I've been in the pastor so long that I've had people call me pastor as a title, and by the Spirit, I knew whose I was a pastor of when they said pastor. You understand that now, Jennifer. I did it a lot longer than Jennifer. But there were people say pastor out of respect and honor, but I'm not their pastor. And in some cases, it's just a title. Other people, no, God has placed you into my life to speak into my life, and I'm not afraid of you speaking into my life. When they say pastor, there's a different heart attitude. And like when something good would happen to us, we've got people like that, well, they're pastoring themselves. But when they heard, our first book got published, or we went on Sid Roth, or our book got published, or we did this, or we did that, on the other end of the phone, they would cry. That's a good heart attitude. When something good happens to us and they cry, what does that tell you? So they're knit in a way unlike other knittings. Now, if they cried because it didn't happen to them, that's a different scenario altogether. But those are five elements that are the context of true change, real change, and the heart of a worshiper. So now I want to get to what the Lord had opened up, because I believe that we're going to raise up worshipers like you've never seen before, and that the efficacy of the Holy Spirit is going to pour out on prepared hearts. And so no matter how hard this sounds, this is the preparation of the heart, right? Attitude of the heart. And I want you to turn in your Bibles to Ezekiel chapter 44. Ezekiel 44. I see an outline here that I just love. I just love this outline. It's basically saying, remember, these people always go astray in my heart. They shall not enter my rest. God's basically saying, I am searching out and looking for true worshipers that will worship me in what? Spirit. It's got to be from the heart. And two, it's got to be according to the way I want them to worship. And look at this picture. This is an Old Testament picture of the Zadok priesthood. But in Ezekiel 44:15, it says, "But the priests and the Levites, the sons of Zadok, who kept charge of my sanctuary when the children of Israel went astray." When the children of Israel went astray from me in their heart, it says, "These sons of Zadok who kept charge, they shall come near to me and minister to me. They will stand before me to offer me the fat and the blood." The outflow of intimate relationship. And basically he's saying that these priests, these Levites, these sons of Zadok, when the children of Israel went astray, they are the ones that are going to come near to me to minister to me. This is the call to worship. I'm calling forth these people that will not go astray in their heart, that they're basically going to come near to me to minister to me, and they shall stand before me to offer the blood and the fat. They're going to offer me the intimate relationship that I hunger and desire. Secondly, it says, "They shall enter my sanctuary, and they shall come near to my table to minister to me, and they will keep my charge." Verse 17, "And it shall be whenever they enter the gates of the inner court, they shall put on linen garments, no wool shall come upon them while they minister within the gates of the inner court or within the house. They shall have linen turbans on their heads and linen trousers on their body. They shall not clothe themselves with anything that causes sweat." If we've got one mission that Jennifer and I are doing, one part of the entire mission, it's to teach the Bible, the body of Christ, to enter into the rest of God. That too much striving is done in the name of Christianity, too much sweating. We've even used that illustration. If a preacher's up there preaching and he has to work up a sweat, there's probably a little bit of him in there, or he's really out of shape, okay? You shouldn't have to perspire. The beauty of worship should be something that you enter into where it does not cause striving. It does not cause sweat. It should be done with the linen garment, not wool, not working up fervor. It shall not cause sweat. So to minister to God, I want a people that are going to learn how to minister to God and enter into that rest and get lost in God and be changed. But it's going to require the context of change. All those five heart elements, but those five heart elements will bring you into a rest in God and a guaranteed provision that God has. Now look at the second thing that the sons of Zadok, in verse 23, it says, "And they shall teach my people the difference between the holy and the unholy." They will teach my people the difference between the holy and the unholy. It's almost like if I was going to have someone to teach me right from wrong, I'm going to want someone that's not doing wrong. Give me a real worshiper with the right heart attitude to teach me what's right or wrong. And to instruct others, reproduce according to kind, in other words. The third element in Ezekiel 44:23 says, "And cause them to discern between the clean and the unclean." To discern the difference. This is holy, this is not holy, and let me discern the difference. I think it's real important. We touched on this Tuesday night, on the hindrances to discernment. And it's basically that even where people get confused with likes and dislikes, and excitement versus joy, those things can be confusing. Do you believe you can have the joy of the Lord and you can have excitement that's lust? It's not the same as joy. Everybody's going, "Oh my God, I'll never get excited again." No, what I'm saying is it's difficult to make a distinction, but a true worshiper will make that distinction, because what they will do is they will not try to analyze in their head the difference between excitement and lust and joy, but they will basically be able to discern in their heart, is this clean or unclean? And if it feels unclean, you've got your answer, right? If it doesn't feel clean, there's something unclean about it. You have just now discerned the distinctive difference. These sons of Zadok are going to be able to do this. These are going to be a new breed of worshipers that's going to emerge in the days ahead. As God is wooing as the preparation of his bride, we have to return to first love. The second thing, Ezekiel 44, verse 24. In controversy, they will stand as judges and judge it according to my judgments. You know, people have unsanctified mercy as a value system sometimes. It's going to take both the, did you know that even the kindness of God can be both stern as well as gentle? It can be the mercy and the severity of God. The kindness of God can be very stern to the people who want license and God doesn't bless them. It'll seem like he's not kind. But in reality, he's true to his nature and he's holy. And I will be kind to who I will be kind, and I will show mercy on who I will show mercy. But his laws, he's going to want worshipers to adjudicate. Do you believe that worshipers can adjudicate? You know what I mean by adjudicate? Adjudicate means rule and reign. If someone's going to judge between this and that, I want someone that's a worshiper. If they're a worshiper of God, they're going to minister out of a discernment, because it already told me a worshiper is going to increase their discernment. And I'm going to use them to discern, to distinguish right from wrong, truth from error, good from evil. Not only that, but what kind of good and what kind of evil on top of that. That's the discernment that's going to be given to a true worshiper. They're not going to struggle with many of the things Christians struggle with, because the spiritual man discerns all things. That means a worshiper should be discerning all of life, not just parts of life, all of life. The spiritual man, 1 Corinthians 2, the spiritual man discerns all things, and the spiritual woman discerns all things. All right? That's the third element, to discern between the unclean and the clean. Clearly, God has elevated their spiritual authority, hasn't he? To teach the people the difference between the holy and the unholy, to discern the difference between the clean and the unclean, to adjudicate and stand as judges. And the fifth element, I find, is the most precious, and it was actually kind of the balance in my own personal life of how I evaluated where I was in worship. And the last one was, it shall be in regard to their inheritance. I am their inheritance. It's not about what they get. Did you know these sons of Zadok didn't get the property like others did? They were provided for by the people, but they had no inheritance. You shall give them no possession in Israel, for I will be their present. Who made that statement early on was Abraham. Abraham says, for he is my exceedingly great reward. My satisfaction is in him. There is a satisfaction that I think explains why Jennifer and I say, I don't need a lot of entertainment, not that it's bad. I don't need vacations, not that it's bad. I don't need a lot of these things because my satisfaction is in him. Once you find that satisfaction, my meat is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish the work. It's like a joyful journey. It's a divine romance of wills. His will is his pleasure. It's not drudging duty. Once you enter into drudging duty, you're missing the point anyway. I don't know what you're doing, but it's something religious. But you're missing the best part of it. Now, if God's calling forth people like the sons of Zadok, what would it look like? Are you curious what it would look like? God gave me a picture a long, long time ago of what it would look like, because I struggled with this. But, you know, that the world might believe by their love one toward another. But I say, but God, none of these people, even under times of a great awakening, none of these people are perfect. So what would they look like? Because I know they're not perfect. And the word the Lord gave me was adequate. Which I can't define that. He says, an adequate witness. In the upper room, they couldn't have been perfect people. probably the ones that would never come together left. But all they needed was a measure of unity that would be an adequate witness, not a perfect people. And basically, when they came together as one, not perfect people, but they came together as one, there was an adequate relationship. There's four adequates that he revealed to me. What is this new Zadok priesthood going to look like? What is this Zadok worshiper going to look like as an individual, regardless of titles? What do they look like? Regardless of function, because this is a lifestyle. This isn't about singing in front of the church. This is about a lifestyle. The adequate relationship. Now, when they saw the boldness of Peter and John, they perceived that they were uneducated, untrained men. They marveled and they realized they had been with Jesus. It doesn't matter what your gift or calling is. Wouldn't you like that to be said about you? That an adequate witness is that someone knows that you've been in the presence of God. They know you've been with Jesus, regardless of your gifts and your talents. An adequate relationship. Element number two, an adequate witness. The kingdom of God consists of and is based not on talk, but power. How many times have you heard that? The kingdom of God is not in word, but in power. But you know what we need to define power? Moral power and excellence of soul. I love the power gifts, but I'm more impressed when someone's got moral excellence and power of soul, that when their soul is being ruled, spirit ruled, you see the nature and the character of God more pronounced than their gifts. Moral power, excellence of soul, that is an adequate witness. Adequate maturity is the third element. Till we all come to the unity of the faith, the knowledge of a Son of God, unto a perfect man, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. Full Stature Ministries was named basically as the part of the family mission is to grow up the body, no baby food. If you want baby food or you're very fragile, thin-skinned, you probably should go somewhere else because you're going to get offended. Because in reality, God says grow up before you go up. If you're of the persuasion that you're just going to hang on, not apply yourself to life, and hope that Jesus comes and snatches you out of this terrible old world, then you're in the wrong place, because we want you to grow up before you go up, all right? So we believe that that's the mandate for full stature. So God handed out gifts of apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, teacher to train Christ's followers to be skilled servant workers, working within the body of Christ till we're all moving rhythmically and easily with one another in unity. That's an adequate witness. That's an adequate maturity. What level of maturity? What's adequate maturity? In unity. Oh my goodness. Most people are stuck in being a rugged individual and think they're all grown up because they can handle things by themselves. No, you're not grown up until you're interdependent. And then it's graceful response. Fully mature adults, fully developed within and without, fully alive like Christ. The fourth element, adequate reproduction. 2 Corinthians 3, you are an epistle written in our hearts, known and read by all men. Clearly you are an epistle of Christ, ministered by us, written not with ink, but by the Spirit of the living God, not on tablets of stone, but on tablets of flesh, that is the heart, the source of true worship and adequate reproduction. You reproduce according to the change that's taken place in your heart, or lack thereof. You reproduce according to kind. But God says, make disciples, instruct them in the practice of all that I commanded you this day. That adequate presentation is a picture of the kind of image that's going to be revealed in the worshipers who are like sons of Zadok in the days ahead. I'm just going to believe that right now that there is an opportunity to be challenged to come forth and respond to the call. Audra, could you come up and do some? I want us to have an opportunity to respond to the call of worship. If God is laying on our heart an unfolding story of his plans and his purposes for us, he basically said, in these end times, I'm going to startle you with my goodness. And even in the midst of controversy and difficult circumstances and difficult people, I'm going to reveal my goodness to you. And if you will soak in my goodness, and I did for weeks, and God, I was saying, God, how do I reciprocate? He says, I'm going to take you into a deeper level of worship. You reciprocate by being a worshiper. You reciprocate by honoring me and declaring and decreeing in your life. But worship has to become more of a lifestyle. Less of a function and more of a lifestyle in attitude and disposition of the heart. No baby food this morning, but we don't apologize for being challenged because there's always more in God. Do you agree? No matter how grounded you are in the Lord, no matter how much you love him, there's always a greater abandonment to him that he becomes bigger in our lives. So Father, with this day, we reevaluate and we say that perhaps I've gone astray in my heart and didn't even know it. If any of those areas are weak, I welcome the searching of my heart. I want to be God searched, not self-searched, but God searched. And I am opening up my heart afresh and anew to entering into that covenant. If this message seems too hard, you're failing to realize that it's by grace that this is accomplished. What he's looking for is humility, not dead works. He doesn't want you to try harder. He wants to develop within you a more implicit trust in him, a greater yielding and a greater surrendering. So Father, right now I say, if the trumpet is calling forth and there's a call to being a worshiper as a lifestyle, then cultivate those attitudes of my heart. Cultivate those elements where I have gone astray or I've become indifferent. And I'm asking right now, God, purge the leaven that I might offer up a pure, sweet sound unto your name. Let's stand together before we dismiss. And I want us to do something that we've grown accustomed not to do, and that is, can you want to lift up your hands? I watch football on TV and all that, and I see unsaved people, totally uninhibited and abandoned to their God. How much more could we just lift our hands today and honor him and say, thank you, God? And if in any way I've been indifferent, you make the difference in my life. For I enter into the context and I say, I'm going to worship according to the way you want worshiped, not according to what's comfortable to me. I no longer want to worship a God of convenience, but a God of conviction. Let that covenant be your conviction in my heart. Cause me to ever deepen that commitment to you, to live for you and serve you all the days of my life. If you're watching by Ustream, this is a time to rededicate to those five inner elements, those five heart attitudes, if you're going to mature as a worshiper who will not be worn out in the days of adversity, but you're going to be strong and know your God and do exploits in the days ahead. And you're going to do it from the seated position, and you're going to be Sabbath sons and Sabbath daughters that have going to learn how to enter into his rest, how to stay in that rest, and how that when you get out of that rest, how to get back in to that rest and enter into the shalom of God and the prosperity that he's got for all of us to grow in the plans and the purposes of God. He's going to cause us to get wealth to establish his covenant in the earth. So Father, rekindle the family mission. Rekindle that I have someone that speaks life into me, that I'm responsible to. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, God, that I'm a giver. Where my treasure is, that's where my heart is. Cause me to reevaluate heart attitudes, because you want me to worship from the heart, but you also have a structure in which you've showed me the way to worship. And I surrender to that today afresh and anew. Let the Spirit of God guide and direct me in the transformation in the days ahead. But I'm going to be a Sabbath son, and I'm going to be a Sabbath daughter unto the Lord. And my fellowship is going to be intense with Almighty God. And our relationship is going to be real and genuine. And I'm going to know in my knower that everything that I have belongs to you. All that I am belongs to you. And so therefore, I submit myself afresh and anew today as I continue to soak in your goodness. And we praise you in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Amen. It's a new day. Let's ask the Holy Spirit to cleanse our heart from idolatry. All that John talked about was the love of God, and then ended with, stay away from idols. Don't let anything come between what you and I have together. May we be a community of priests, sons and daughters. Thank you, Lord. Worship in spirit and truth with a fresh new dedication, discernment, authority, no sweat. And my satisfaction is that He is my exceedingly great reward. God Himself is my inheritance. I need nothing else. I've got Him. Soak in His goodness. Release the joy. In His presence, there's fullness of joy. And the joy of the Lord is going to be our strength in the days ahead. A mighty army raising up with spiritual muscle being applied right now. A fresh appreciation of what the blood of Christ has cleansed. Release physical healings to flow through this physical body right now. Christ the healer rising with healing in His wings right now. Let the supernatural element of Christ cleansing His temple, healing His body. May we open up to one another and increase relationally, spirit to spirit. Each part gives, each part receives. We are being knit together, ligaments. God is supernaturally joining. He's even joined people that are watching on Ustream from other states, other places. There's a knitting taking place. It's a beautiful tapestry of God. There's going to be relationships outside of this local church that are basically knitting together. Be a worshipers of God, Sabbath sons and Sabbath daughters, entering into the rest of God and worshiping and working. Ezra 3:1 is coming to pass even right now. For they came together as one man to worship. They came together, Ezra 3:1, as one man, one corporate man, coming together to worship and listen and hear the word of the Lord, to hear that word and worship in spirit and in truth as one man. Open your heart and say, to be that corporate one man, that I am opening my spirit to be connected with other believers, to know them according to the Spirit, not according to the flesh. God relationship, a God knitting that's corporate. God
God is opening the windows of heaven. He's pouring out blessings. You're going to be suddenly startled by His goodness, even this very day. He's pouring out favor, extravagance, blessings that have been stacked up in the heavens, tipped over and poured out. Right now, from your spirit, release heavenward. Out of my belly flows a worship from the heart. Out of my belly is, I am sowing into the heavenly clouds that it might rain down. As I am worshiping and sowing into the heavens, seeding the clouds with worship and praise and prayer. As I'm seeding those clouds, they're getting full. They're getting full. It's getting weighty, and it's about to break through and come forth and water the earth. As the soil of my heart breaks free and the living waters flow out from underneath, so it shall rain down from heaven upon us the blessings of God. Sowing into that heavenly account where the prayers of the saints are filling the vessels and that the vessels are being tipped and poured over upon us. As we release worship to the heavenlies, let us connect horizontally with everyone in the room and say, our Father, our Father. We're lifting up the voice of one accord. Our Father, we worship you. Our Father, it's not just me. Our Father, which art, we honor you and we worship you and we lift that up to you. Sabbath son and a Sabbath daughter right now. Feel like a mild saturation of peace encompassing you. In His presence there's fullness of joy. The joy of the Lord is His strength rising up on the inside. Getting thicker. Sons and daughters, God is incubating upon you in a canopy of His goodness. Drink it in. Let every cell of your physical body welcome the King of Glory. Every external awareness of His presence is going to penetrate, saturate, cause me to radiate that He puts within me now. Like a sponge, I'm drinking it in, but I'm going to release it from this place. I'm a Sabbath son. Say it out loud. Once there is an inner awareness, I am a Sabbath son or a Sabbath daughter. I am a Sabbath son or a Sabbath daughter. I am a Sabbath son or a Sabbath daughter. I'm encapsulated by the presence of the living God. He's incubating on me. I'm drawing forth. It's increasing. It's increasing. Because of your stillness, you're honoring God. Because of your stillness and your lack of striving, you're making space for Him. And He is honoring the fact that you've honored Him. Thank you. we could expect the weight of his glory. We welcome it to come down from the heavenly clouds. I welcome the weight to come down upon us like a blanket, like a mantle. All that's been sowed in through the prayers of the saints, may it come down and blanket us. Bottom fall out of your yielding. Yield. This is good, God, but I want the bottom to fall out. I yield to a significant, extravagant lover. And the weight of that glory, I welcome it to be so saturated with you. You a little bit, but can you feel the presence? You carry that with you, because I believe there was an element of impartation that you own. You own it. It's your Jesus, and you can give it. Thank you, Lord.
You've been listening to Pastor Dennis Clark and Dr. Jennifer Clark of Full Stature Ministries at forgive123.com. Full Stature Ministries reserve all copyright protections under applicable law. Our copyright policy is available at our website, forgive123.com. For more information about Full Stature Ministries and additional life-transforming materials, please visit forgive123.com.